Today, we're here to discuss one of my absolute favorite topics, why IT architecture careers are one of the best careers in the future. I am here with my friend and an extreme expert, David Linthicum, who's an expert on cloud and generative AI. And together, we're going to talk about why IT architecture careers are one of the best careers for the future. So, you know, David, you know I love architecture careers, and I know you've been an architect, and I've been an architect for close to 60 years if you add our time together. In today's world, with all the things that are happening, I think architecture careers are one of the brightest future. I feel like they're the most in demand, and I even feel like they're the most strategic. Would you agree with that, David?
I would very much agree with that, Mike. I mean, right now, I think we're in a bit of a crisis because we do not have enough talented architects that are able to solve the problems that are in front of enterprises today. And so your ability to obtain the talent and the processes and understand the best practices and the pragmatic use of technology to configure to bring most value back to the business is absolutely an imperative for us to be successful with the technology. So if you decide that that's your career path, you're going to be well treated. You're going to find a extremely viable and lucrative career path, and extremely rewarding too. Your ability to go out there and solve problems today that take businesses to the next level.
And I've noticed that as well. In my youth, I did spend about 6 months as an engineer, and then I shifted over to an architect career, and I was treated with so much more respect. I earned more, and my quality of life was so much better. Instead of coming in at 3 o'clock in the morning to fix something broken on the network, I was meeting with clients and discussing their business. And to me, it was just so much more fun. It was easier. I actually got paid more, so I loved it. Now, David, one of the reasons I feel that architecture careers are so needed is related to the success or failures of most technology projects. McKinsey states that 70% of all digital transformation projects fail. A recent article in CIO magazine found that over 50% of all cloud projects actually fail to deliver any business value whatsoever. And to me, the architect is that person that takes the business vision from the executives, understands the business processes, and optimizes technology solutions to actually go improve that business. So, David, would you agree with projects being failures and the critical need for architects?
Yeah, I'm seeing that data as well, Mike, and I see it, within my clients, my career as a consultant, and I see it in just the trends of what's coming back from the stats. And it's devastating to me because you got to remember there's billions of dollars that are being spent where there's a lack of value that's coming back from the business from their investments. And primarily, it comes down to people making systemically bad decisions in how to pick technology, what technology to leverage, when the sequence to leverage the technology, and how to select business problems to solve within the business. And that's what architects do. So the fundamental role and the fundamental value of an architect is the ability to get between a massively complex array of technology that we have in front of us today, including generative AI, and they're also understanding the business. You need to do both. You need to have a business acumen. You need to have the technology acumen. You need to marry both together to make the correct decisions. So you're sending the business on the correct path. And unless we get that, we're just going to continue to see these stats where digital transformations don't return value. Cloud computing architectures fail. We're not receiving the value we're going to get from cloud computing. Most of this is self-inflicted wounds. If we just do better from an architectural standpoint, we'll see the value. We just need to have more people out there to understand how to do this.
And David, you mentioned some really interesting things there regarding the cloud architect skills. One of the things I've noticed is people confuse cloud engineering, cloud administration with cloud architecture. And people come to me and they've been trying to become an architect for years and they've learned how to code Python and they've learned Linux and they're writing bash shell scripts and they're writing Terraform. And they know all the how-to, but they don't know architecture. They know how to build, which is engineering. You mentioned the skills business acumen, and I think that's really important. If an architect is going to optimize business performance, they must understand business. And because of that, we hit the supply and demand curve of the architecture careers, which makes them pay so well and be in such demand. The architect needs to have that business acumen. They need to lead large teams of people. We need to manage stakeholders. We need to go sell our solution to the C-suite and to the board. We may need to build a business case to show the value of the solution. We're presenting at conferences. We're writing thought leadership documents. We're not really touching the technology in our architect roles, but We have to understand how the technology works. And people often don't understand the difference between configuring and knowing how systems work. And I like to say the following. You know, I can teach someone how to put some commands on a router. Router BGP 65312, neighbor 192.168, remote AS 65313. And then all of a sudden, 100,000 routes come into my system. But that's the easy part. It's what happens when those routes come into the system. Does that affect my sales team that's based in New York City, my manufacturing team that's based in Vietnam, remote tech support people that might be in Nigeria? And all those things can happen under the scenes from just that simple command. That's why, to me, I think architecture is such a specialty, because it takes so much technical knowledge in how systems work. And also, marry all those business and executive skills. To me, there's an enormous shortage right now. And unless organizations start training architects and not giving certifications with trained engineering, this is an exciting career to me, because huge demand, no supply, high pay. Would you agree?
I would very much agree. I mean, right now we're at in a crisis mode where the demand for architects of all kinds, generative AI architects, IT architects, cloud architects, network architects, is probably increased threefold in the last 5 years, you know, certainly since the pandemic was around, things like that. And the supply just isn't there. We're not turning out enough architects who are capable to take things to the next level. And companies are doing a couple of things. Number one, they're settling for hiring people at a lower talent range, probably who are more engineers. I don't understand the ability, the things you need to understand to be an architect, to understand the business, how they kind of marry together. And it's now a huge opportunity for people to look at the nature of this career path and understand some stuff, and understand that it's going to be you learning lots of stuff and how things configure together. It's not about you getting into the weeds on any of this stuff. It's really just figuring out how technology is applied in a specific way that's going to be the best for the business, and understanding what the business is. And it's a huge opportunity right now in the marketplace. In other words, if I was going to advise somebody who was going to move forward to the cloud, if they had some sort of a technology career, they're just starting as a programmer, things like that, I would say, if you get these skills and you get these technologies, the world's your oyster. You got lots of organizations out there that are willing to pay you a lot of money, as long as you're able to produce and understand what you need to understand. So get the knowledge you need, get into the marketplace, get that first job, and you'll find that you'll have a career that's going to pay you way more than anybody else in the field. In fact, job survey after job survey, the number one career growth path and demand growth path, and also the highest pay, is going to be with an architect. It's either going to be a network architect, cloud architect, generative AI architect, what have you. And if you decide to focus on that as your career path, you're going to be in a much better position than you are today.
And that's exactly how I feel. Plus, there's something else that I really love about architecture careers. They're human-oriented, meaning managing stakeholders, giving presentations, selling, meeting with executives and finding their needs, leading large teams. And why I love the human-oriented thing is, if I look at the professionals that are out there, and we have our engineers, the best engineers we're always going to need, because they're going to be able to solve problems that no one can. But an entry-level career, like an entry-level programmer, not a senior programmer, but an entry-level programmer, or an entry-level cloud admin or sysadmin, a lot of those skills can actually be done by AI at the entry level. But you can't replace an architect with AI, because who's going to go influence the client to spend $1 billion on technology? Who's going to lead those teams? Who's going to entertain those clients? Who's going to build the business case and manage stakeholders? It's human-oriented. So not only is it a skill for the future, not only does it have such a degree of skills required business and technology that people get paid well, but they can't really be replaced by AI.
They cannot. And you got to remember, this is an array of skills that you need to have. You need to have oral communication, written communication. You have to have relationship capabilities. You have to know how to get along with people. You know, have to know how to lead a team. You have to know understanding some of the aspects of the technology, but not getting too much into it. And so this really is an executive role when you get right down to it. And so you're going to have to presence. You're going to have a leadership, some leadership capabilities, communication capabilities. things that I think a lot of people who enter the technology career path don't think they need, but it's absolutely an imperative for all technology career paths, but more so in the architect, because the architect is dealing with people. That's what architects do. They certainly deal with the configuration and the concepts of technology, but at the end of the day, this is dealing with leadership, stakeholders, investors, team members, vendors, all kinds of people, and your ability to get them to understand what your needs are and how they need to move in a particular direction. And that's a talent I don't think many people have, but it's an absolutely imperative that you have that as if you're an architect.
And that's another thing that I like about architecture careers. It's not like you can learn how to be an architect by just passing a certification. Because the certification is about, here's the name of somebody's service, like a database, and here's how you set it up. But architects have two problems with that. One is we don't set up services anyway. That's what the engineering teams do. And two, when we take a proprietary certification, it tends to induce bias on us. Whatever the vendor is trying to bias you towards, whether that be serverless, whether it be a proprietary application. And the problem is, as an architect, we can't afford to be biased. We have to be open-minded. And you know what my favorite technology is the one that solves my customer's problem. I'm not a serverless advocate. I'm not a monolith advocate. I'm not a microservices advocate. I'm a customer advocate. So I know you've written about this. I've heard you discuss this. How big of a problem do you think bias is in architecture careers?
It's absolutely number one reason why people fail to deliver the value around cloud architecture, IT architecture, whatever business systems you're building. They approach the problem with a predetermined conclusion of what they think the solution is going to be. So it's going to be a particular brand, AWS, Microsoft, Google. It's going to be a particular subsystem like serverless. It's going to be a particular, system, which is generative AI, which is a very powerful technology. We absolutely should not be applied in every kind of problem out there. So you're approaching this problem with a completely open mind in terms of, I'm going to understand what the business needs. I'm going to understand the use case for this particular need for the system. And I'm going to configure technology, which is going to be based on every technology that exists on this planet, not just one vendor, not just one type of technology, not just cloud, not just not cloud, but the ability to truly have an open mind in terms of making sure you're picking the best of breed technology to configure for this purpose. In doing that, you're going to deliver a system that's going to be completely optimized for the business purpose that you're picking. And if you have biases, you're limiting your selection to a particular cloud brand, a particular subsystem, then you're going to be building a system that, guess what? It's going to work, but it's probably going to cost 3 to 10 times the amount of money to build, deploy, and operate. And if you're doing that, you've failed. You're not providing the business with the most valuable solution that's able to return the most value to the business. And that's your goal. That's what you do as an architect.
And, because I come from that healthcare internal medicine background, I like to say that architecture and medicine are effectively the same career. In medicine, someone comes to the office complaining of a problem. We then ask them some questions about the problem. We examine their systems, we make a diagnosis, and then give them a plan. Like, as an architect, somebody has a problem, and that's why they call us. We ask them questions, we evaluate their systems, we make a diagnosis, we give them a plan. Now, in medicine, they call it a prescription. In architecture, they call it an architecture. But, to me, it's really the same thing. And I remember when I learned internal medicine, you couldn't just love Pfizer pills or Merck pills. You had to give your patient the right thing. So, yeah, I'm glad in medicine, it wasn't a vendor certification. It was a licensure. It was understanding anatomy, pharmacology, kinesiology, pharmacokinetics, and everything necessary to design systems. So I kind of love that. And with architecture. So here's my architecture picks for 2024 and beyond. I'm sure you may have yours. Mine is the cloud architect, the enterprise architect, the security architect, the network AI architect, because nothing works without the network, and the AI architect. Do you have any other future careers that you see in the architecture world?
No, I think you really picked the top ones that I would name, Mike. I mean, ultimately, IT architect, enterprise architect, with someone who's, doing different things at a macro level, but the ability to understand we're going to build AI systems, the ability to do the network architecture, And, you know, the ability to do, you know, specialized database things. There is a role for a database architect. That may be one you may want to list, even though there is data scientists and data engineers that you get in there as well. So we're getting these sub-disciplines within the architecture field, which I think are important, because I think that we're going to have to work within these sub-disciplines, but still having an understanding how the other disciplines work. You can't work as a generative AI architect unless you understand how networks function. And databases function and systems function and how the business functions. All this stuff is interrelated. So I think all these paths are legitimate paths. And I think that, you know, people who pick one of these as a discipline, they're going to be very happy with the outcome in their career.
I totally agree with you. David, I want to thank you for sharing your expertise on architecture careers, the cloud architect, the enterprise architect, the AI architect, the network architect, the database architect. It's all about helping our clients be more successful by leveraging technology to improve their business performance. David, I want to thank you for joining us today, and I look forward to doing the next video with you.
You got it, Mike. Thank you.